Hello. Today we'll be speaking about NEET PG exam pattern regarding biochemistry. So biochemistry NEET PG exam, you all know you will be appearing for NEET PG exams, and you know the purpose of the PG exam. This is a qualifying as well as a ranking examination. So you will be qualifying as well as they will be giving a ranking for the entire country. Even though the counseling will happen at the state level and different university level, but the ranking will be similar. So it's very important to score good rank in NEET PG exams. And the periodicity, you know that it is an annual exam once in a year. Pattern, it is MCQ based. There will be four choices, and single best response will be taken as the correct choice. And the time allotted will be 3 hours 30 minutes. Then negative marking, you already know, it is 1 mark will be deducted for every wrong answer, and 4 marks will be awarded for every correct response. Syllabus, they say it is as per graduate medical education, but it covers most topics which come under medical education and policies and other things. And mode of conduct will be computer based. So coming to biochemistry as such, it covers around 16 marks out of 300. But the questions which are coming in even pharmacology, in pathology, in some pediatrics, inborn error of metabolism, and in medicine, like many syndromes and deficiencies in the diseases, and ENT ophthal, I can see example of homocystinuria, the lens dislocation. So biochemistry is not just for 16 marks, and 16 marks is also too much for a competitive exam like NEET. So concentrating on biochemistry will give you edge in many other subjects too. So coming to what are the type of questions you will be getting in a NEET exams. So if you know what are the type of questions you are facing, you have to face in the exam, it will be very easy for your preparation side. So there are something called fact-based question. You know or you don't know. So this kind of question you have to prepare. We will be helping you to prepare, note all those fact-based questions so that you are well aware of those facts so that you can easily perform in your NEET exams. Like in this question, there is a 21st amino acid. You know there are 20 amino acid. So they have asked 21st. What is 21st amino acid? So they have given a choice of unusual amino acid which are present: ornithine, citrulline, selenocysteine, and pyrrolizine. This amino acid you are not even heard of, or they are not the common amino acid which are present in almost all proteins. So the way they choose the choices also, it is to confuse you. And this fact-based question, you will be able to answer only when you know what is 21st amino acid. You can't guess. You can't do the guesswork there. So the answer for 21st amino acid is selenocysteine. So you have to know, just know this, know the answer. You can't do anything else with this fact-based question. These are facts which are there in the books. You have to memorize or you have to know somehow. So one more fact-based question is serotonin is. They have asked the chemical name for serotonin. We all know serotonin, a neurotransmitter, and they have asked for chemical name. And look at the choice they are given: D5-hydroxytryptophan, 5-hydroxytryptamine, 5-carboxytryptamine, and 5-carboxytryptophan. Even if you guess, it is very difficult because they are all sounding similar. The choices they have given sound similar. So here you should know it's an amine derivative of tryptophan is serotonin. This is the fact. So if tryptophan is the modified or derived and it's converted to amine, it becomes serotonin. So the answer for this is 5-hydroxytryptamine. Now coming to similar question with little clinical application. They have asked 5-hydroxyindole acetic acid in urine is due to. They asked it is due to. Here the choices are pheochromocytoma, carcinoid syndrome, phenylketonuria, alkaptonuria. In this type of question, if you have a little application, you will be able to answer those questions. You know, in phenylketonuria, the urine has phenylketones. In alkaptonuria, it is homozygotic acid. In pheochromocytoma, it has nothing to do with 5-hydroxyindole acetic acid, because in pheochromocytoma, you have epinephrine and norepinephrine. So the ultimate choice would be a carcinoid syndrome. It will be the answer for this. But again, you should know in each of these conditions, like alkaptonuria, phenylketonuria, and pheochromocytoma, what are exactly present in the urine. Then only you will be able to deduce the answer and able to answer it. This question can be easily different. Homozygotic acid in urine is seen in due. Then the answer would be alkaptonuria or epinephrine or something else would be in urine. Then they will change the choices and will give the MCQs. So these kind of questions you will be able to answer once you know in the entire textbook or in the biochemistry or any subjects what are those facts you need to know. And the course which is designed in ACE exam you will be able to grasp those questions so that you have an edge over other people. Like the next question, it's again a fact base, but little biochemistry application is required in this. Kyon urine is formed from metabolism of. So in this one, you should know different amino acid metabolism. What are the important product? You can't know all the 20 amino acid, all the products, all the metabolism of 20 amino acid. But important product of each of the amino acid, you should be able to know what are the products which are formed after metabolism of the amino acid. Here, the answer is kyourine pathway leads to production of NAD. That is nicotinamide deaminase. Nicotinamide deaminase. Right. So this kyourine is linked to NAD formation. NAD is linked to tryptophan. This is how you will be able to answer this type of question. Kyourine is formed from metabolism of tryptophan. And kyourine, you should know, it leads to production of NAD. Okay. So glycine metabolism is very important, or any amino acid metabolism is very important, but you can't know all the amino acid metabolism of all the 20 amino acid. So what best you can do is, you know what are the important products which are derived from those metabolism, right? Here it is glycine metabolism. Here you can see there is huge molecules which are derived from glycine. Glycine is the simplest amino acid. Simplest amino acid. It can be derived from serine, and also it can form serine. And here you can see, once it is formed serine, it can form pyruvate and ultimately glucose. So this kind of metabolism, from amino acid you are getting glucose, means you are getting new glucose. Right, that mechanism is called gluconeogenesis, new glucose formation. So new glucose formation from a non-carbohydrate source, that is gluconeogenesis. So one product you get is glucose, basic product. For any amino acid, the ultimate excretory product is urea. So urea is produced from all amino acid, and it is no exception for glycine also. So glycine will produce urea via ammonia, right? Glycine is a component of 20 amino acid, which are almost exclusively or almost present in proteins. They are all present. All 20 amino acid will be a constituent of any protein, with few exceptions. right? So glycine will produce proteins or a component of protein. Then you can see there is choline. Choline, you know, lecithin is a component of lecithin. So it is from glycine you get choline, and choline is a component of lecithin. Lecithin, you know, respiratory distress syndrome, which is a name given for immature lung, which are formed because of prematurity in a newborn baby, right? A newborn, if they are premature, there is respiratory distress syndrome, that is because of lack of lecithin, which forms surfactant, which is a protein, which is necessary for proper lung function. For that, you require choline. So they can ask in any combination, like absence of lysine surfactant is linked to glycine metabolism, carbohydrate, amino acid, tryptophan metabolism or serotonin metabolism. So you should be aware what these products are formed or ultimately formed. So if there is something called choline, it should be linked to lecithin, surfactant, respiratory distress syndrome and prematurity. So these are the points which you should be remembering, key points for each of the molecules which you study. Then you know glycoxic acid and oxalate. You know oxalate crystals which can form stones. So it also is derived from glycine. Then most important molecule which you come across in your clinical scenario is creatinine. So you know that creatinine is estimated in almost all the patient, hospitalized patient, to assess their kidney function, right? You can assess their kidney function by estimating creatinine. So it is basically a excretory product. So the creatinine will be excreted. So from where this creatinine has come? Creatinine has come from a molecule creatine. So creatine is derived from glycine. So what is the function of creatine? Creatine forms creatine phosphate. Creatine phosphate, right? Creatine phosphate. So the role of creatine phosphate in our body is to store energy. So energy currency of our body is ATP. ATP is energy currency, but it can't be stored. So what body does, it will take phosphate from ATP and it binds with creatine to form creatine phosphate, right? So why the body does like this is, during fight or flight, if you want to run away or you want to fight, the muscles require instant energy. You can't start producing ATPs at those situations. So it need to be having a ready source of energy. So that instant source of energy is creatine phosphate. So the breakdown product of creatine phosphate is creatinine, which is excreted in the kidneys, right? And which we estimate to know the kidney function, not to know the muscle function, right? This point you should understand. So creatinine is a waste product of creatine, and it is used to assess kidney function or the excretory function of the kidney. And next important product which is produced from glycine is purine ring. It provides molecules for purine rings. It provides two carbon molecules and one nitrogen molecule. And the numbers which are given here, 4, 5 and 7, they are the ring number. When we talk about nucleic acid or nucleotide metabolism, I will talk about the ring numbers and all those things. And this also is important with regard to your MCQ point of view. which molecule is contributing to which component of the purine ring. And purine ring is a component of your nucleic acid, which make up your DNA and RNA. So the other component of DNA and RNA is pyrimidine. So purine and pyrimidine will help in formation of DNA and RNA, right? So for that also you require glycine. Then the next important molecule which is produced from glycine is heme. Heme, you know that it's a component of hemoglobin and also cytochrome 450 and many other non-heme proteins. When we talk about heme in detail, we'll be explaining non-heme proteins also. Heme is very much necessary for hemoglobin and cytochrome 450 formation. And for heme to be formed, it is produced from ALA, that is aminolevulinic acid. ALA, for formation of ALA, aminolevulinic acid, glycine is necessary. So this ALA is a derived product of amino acid glycine. Okay. Next important molecule is glutathione. Glutathione, you should know what is this glutathione. This glutathione is a component of your antioxidant system. Antioxidant, antioxidant that fights against reactive oxygen species. Reactive oxygen species are the oxygen radicals, free radicals, which are produced from body metabolism, or it can be derived from outside food also. So this reactive oxygen species will cause damage to multiple organs as well as the cellular membrane. Cellular membrane is damaged and organs are also damaged. So the reactive oxygen species need to be controlled. And the controlling molecule in our body is glutathione. So you have to know glutathione means reactive oxygen species, antioxidant which controls reactive oxygen species. And also you should know it is tripeptide. So that means it consists of three peptides. So what are those three peptides? Gamma glutamine, glycine, cysteinyl glycine. So glutamate is there, cysteine is there, and glycine is there. So if they want to ask a question, or they will surely ask this type of question, the amino acids making up glutathione are they would have given glutamate, cysteine, glycine, and they would have given proline, lysine, or whatever other amino acid which they want to be a wrong answer. So you should know glutathione is derived from three amino acids and glycine is one of them. Bile salt, glucocholic acid, and glycinodeoxycholic acid. So these are also derived from glycine. And conjugation, the conjugation is a process of your detox mechanism. That is, you make a polar, non-polar molecule polar so that it is excreted in the kidney, excreted to kidney, right? So that is conjugation. For the conjugation process, you require glycine, right? To make it polar, a non-polar molecule which is insoluble in water, you have to make it polar so that it is excreted in the kidney. That is the conjugation process. And for that conjugation process, you require glycine. So like this, each amino acid will have some set of derived and important products. So you have to know those important products for each amino acid metabolism. So, and you don't have to know the entirety of the metabolism in and out. So what we will be doing is, we will be teaching you those important points, high yielding points necessary for your MCQ preparation. and also your understanding of biochemistry. So coming to next type of questions which they will ask is diagram based. So they will give a schematic diagram. It could be a schematic diagram or it could be a photograph of a diseased person. So like an example, you can take a rickets, bow leg. They would have given a baby with bow legs. The bow legs in baby suggest rickets. Rickets suggest vitamin D deficiency. Okay, or calcium metabolism defects. So these kind of things you should, it should come to your mind when you see a picture. So once you see this kind of this picture, in this example, they are given picture which is branching cogwheel type. So looking at the picture, you should know what is it. It is glycogen molecule. So this is a glycogen molecule. So glycogen molecule is very much important with the MCQ point of view. So we'll be talking in detail of glycogen metabolism, glycogen storage disease and other things. Now coming to the picture, so they are given an arrow here. So arrow suggests means the question is based upon the molecule which is present here in the center, which is shown by the arrow. So the question here is, what is not true about molecule shown in the image? It is required for synthesis of glycogen. Obviously, this is right. What is not true, they have asked. So this is right because it is at the center and it is anchoring few molecules branching out of it. So it might be a molecule which is necessary for glycogen synthesis. Okay. So that is the right choice. Then it's a dimeric protein. Obviously, you are seeing two identical picture here. There is one molecule here, one molecule this. So it's identical. Two proteins are attached to each other and they are similar. So it's a dimeric protein. So that from the choice only you can get what is it. It is a protein and it is something related to glycogen. Then it is binding to some molecule. Here they are given it is glucose. So these are the glucose molecule. So this protein is binding to glucose at specific point. So at glucose it is binding to C6, carbon atom 6. At the amino acid level, means at the protein level, it is binding to amino acid tyrosine, right? So a tyrosine molecule binds with glucose 6 molecule to form a branch point. And this protein name is glycogenin. Glycogenin is the name of the protein and it acts as a primer. It acts as a primer for synthesis of your glycogen molecule, right? So the choice here is it acts as an autocatalytic enzyme. So this protein does not act as an enzyme. It is just a primer through which the glucose molecule branch out. It acts as an anchor and not as an enzyme for binding of the glucose molecule. Glycogen synthase. There is an enzyme called glycogen synthase, is the enzyme which adds the glucose molecule onto the protein, right? So this is about diagram based question. Then coming to pathway based question. This is the favorite of examiners. In the NEET exam, there are so many pathways which are clinically relevant also, and for exam point also, it is very relevant. How to analyze the pathway based question? First, you have to know, looking at the pathway, which pathway this belongs to. Here, you can see glucose is forming pyruvate. Pyruvate is forming alanine. Alanine is going via blood to the liver, right? And it is ultimately forming glucose again. So, here what is happening is alanine is forming glucose. Alanine can be derived from amino acid also. So all the amino acid or most of the amino acid which are there in the muscle are being channeled through alanine via liver to produce glucose. That means there is glucose alanine cycle, right? Or alanine glucose cycle, whichever way you want to take, you can take. So this is alanine glucose cycle, right? So ultimately it is glucose which is being formed, right? So when do you expect glucose to be formed? That is the essence of the question. So the pathway or the cycle shown in the image is important during which condition? So the condition, when do you want glucose? When you are starving. So there are two important things you have to know: starvation and fasting, right? Starvation, what is the difference in starvation and fasting? Fasting, it is for 24 hours. More than 24 hours or more than few days, it becomes starvation. During fasting, you will be utilizing glycogen, which is storage form for energy purpose. After 24 hours, the storage of glycogen will be emptied, right? Then fatty acids are pulled in to provide ATP and ketone bodies. And ketone bodies are utilized by your brain and heart to provide energy, right? And even after that, if the starvation continues, then muscle proteins are broken down into amino acid, and amino acid will provide glucose. So we are getting new glucose from non-carbohydrate source. That pathway is called gluconeogenesis. New glucose from non-carbohydrate source, gluconeogenesis, right? Gluconeogenesis, new glucose generation, gluconeogenesis. So this pathway, alanine glucose cycle, is for starvation. So this is how you have to analyze a pathway based question. If the pathway based question is not straightforward, right? If they are given which condition, like this clinical condition they are given, then you have to analyze like what would be the answer. Next comes the technique based question. So there are some biochemical techniques, molecular and biochemical techniques, which are also source of many MCQs in the past 5 to 10 years, and this year they will be asking CRISPR based question, because this year we got a Nobel Prize in chemistry who worked on CRISPR. Okay. Now the simple question which is there here, which is based on the techniques, is the following principles is used for separation of protein electrophoresis. So they are asking protein electrophoresis. So what are the separation technique used in protein electrophoresis? Okay. So you should know what is electrophoresis and what are the principle behind electrophoresis to answer this kind of question. So there, the choices here are binding affinity of protein to its ligand, migration of protein based on their shape and size, partitioning of protein between stationary and mobile phase, okay, then migration of protein based on charge to mass ratio. Okay, so here the question is directed for electrophoresis. Electrophoresis, you know, there is electrical charge and the protein moves from one charge to other charge depending on the affinity. So out of the four, which are the choices which is based on electrophoresis? So binding affinity, here you are testing the affinity of the protein to bind to the ligand. That is a technique for ELISA or something similar to it. ELISA or your adsorption chromatography. We come to it later. But here the principle is not electric, but the binding affinity of a protein to its ligand. It's a binding affinity. Next, migration of protein based on size and shape. So it is the principle here is migration, not the electrophoresis, electrical current. Then partitioning of protein between stationary and mobile phase. Again, this is a concept of chromatography. Chromatography. Okay. Chromatography is a technique where there is a partitioning between stationary and where the word stationary and mobile phase are used. So, chromatography. Next, migration of protein based on charge to mass ratio. So, now comes the word charge to mass ratio. Okay. So, this is the technique used in mass spectrometry. Just remember the word mass spectrometry. Okay. Mass spectrometry, we use charge to mass ratio and there is migration of protein. And that can be used in electrophoresis also. Right. Now I'll explain you little bit about the different types of techniques which are used in this question. Size exclusion gel chromatography. Size exclusion gel chromatography means there is separation. All these techniques are for protein separation. There is separation of protein based on the mass. So that mass here is size. And they are given the word exclusion means the bigger proteins are separated from smaller protein. So you use a technique where you exclude a kind of one size of the protein from other size of protein and you separate based on the mass of the protein. That is called size exclusion chromatography. The principle behind this is exclusion of different molecular sizes, right? In ion exchange chromatography, if there is a question based on different techniques which are used for separation, when they are given ion exchange, means there is a resin with one type. If there is a positive, if you want to isolate a negative charge protein, so you put a resin with positive charges on it. So negative proteins, the protein which is carrying negative charge will bind to that resin. Here it will bind. So you can have an ion exchange electrophoresis or chromatography, right? It could be anion or cation exchange to separate protein depending on their native charges, net positive or negative charges. Here there is no mass involved. Ion exchange chromatography does not give mass. It depends on the net charge. If it is carrying more charge, it will be bound binding to the cation or anion material, which is even which is called resin. Resin. Right? Cation or anion exchange resins. Then this is a technique. Then there is a technique called NMR and X-ray crystallography. Nuclear magnetic resonance and X-ray crystallography. These techniques will give the structure of a protein. How exactly the protein looks. If you want an example of a coronavirus, which is having a spike protein. So you have to know how exactly the spike protein looks. Then you have to extract the spike protein and see under X-ray crystallography and nuclear magnetic resonance to look exact structure of a spike protein. To look at the entire corona molecule, you require electron microscope, that's all. But to look how the spikes, what are the molecules, what are the structures which are looking at these things, you have to look under NMR or X-ray crystallography. Why you want to look analyze the structure of a given protein. So if you know the amino acids which are present in the spike, you can develop an antibody or you can develop a drug which can bind to that specific amino acid, and you can detect the protein, like in antibody serology used for COVID, this thing. Or you can develop a drug which can block the specific amino acid so that it won't bind to the receptor which are present in human. So that, in for those research, you require exact structural analysis of the protein. For that, we use NMR and X-ray crystallography to get the structures. Next, there is something, some technique called SDS page. SDS page does not yield mass of a native protein because it is denatured while analysis, right? So once you are using SDS page, you won't get the mass because the entire protein is denatured. What you get is identification of that. You can detect that protein, that specific protein is present or absent. So that you can detect using SDS page. These are the techniques, few techniques which are there in biochemistry, which you are need to be aware of to answer a principle or a concept based techniques. Here the example what they are given, what I am showing is gel chromatography, which is also called as size exclusion. You are excluding. I will explain why it is given the name excluding chromatography. Here you can see there are green proteins, then there are blue proteins, there are smaller red proteins, right? Let me change the color. Okay, so here once the force is applied, or once it is allowed to, once the sample is allowed to run, you can see the green proteins are moving faster and they are getting eluted, or they are coming out at the other end earlier than the red protein. And here what happens in size exclusion, these are stationary molecules, or the stationary phase, what they call in chromatography. They carry holes. They are not the solid beads, they are hole. They carry a specific size holes. Once the sample is poured in, smaller molecule enters through this hole and they keep on traveling from bead to bead at a very smaller size speed. The bigger molecule will be able to travel away from the hole because it is not able to enter through the hole, and it is traveling much faster than the red molecule. So that's why it is size excluded. So once you want to separate a particular size, you choose a bead for that particular size, small, larger, very large, and you can easily exclude that protein from other proteins which are present in the sample. So this kind of chromatography separation is called gel size exclusion chromatography, or gel exclusion. The material we use for this bead formation is gel. That's why it is gel chromatography, and more specific name is size exclusion chromatography, right? So these are the techniques based questions. You will be made aware once we go through our classes, and this will help you track those techniques which are based on principle. One question here I have given for your analysis. The patient has a disease that leads to hyper excretion of a protein in urine. Means in urine, you are getting a typic particular type of a protein which is excreted more than normal. So they are asking which methodology is fastest, easiest, and least expensive to determine the molecular weight of native protein in the urine. So they basically want the protein molecular weight, which can be done at the fastest and easiest way. In previously I explained size exclusion chromatography. You want a molecular weight, so you choose a bead for that molecule that will exclude. So you can get weight in SDS page also, but it is not the fastest technique, right? Or easiest, it is time consuming. Okay. And SDS page, I already told, it destroys the protein during process. You can't get native protein. Native protein means an intact protein. So you want an intact protein molecular weight. So you can't choose SDS page. Even though you can detect molecular weight, you can't choose SDS page. So it without destroying the protein, any technique which can separate molecular weight based protein separation, that would be size exclusion. In SDS crystallography and NMR, you can detect the structure, not the weight. Ion exchange also, you can't detect the weight. You can detect the charge. Depending on the charge, it is separated. So knowing different techniques will help you answer this kind of question. Okay. Next question, depending on the technique, is the most widely used method for determining the purity of protein. So here the question is about the purity. They are not asking for the molecular weight. They are not asking for the charge. They are asking for purity. So in gel exclusion or the size exclusion chromatography, you can, if the molecular, if the protein are of similar size, you won't be getting a particular protein purity. You will be getting a mixture of protein of same size. So gel exclusion, you can't, obviously you can't determine a purity of the protein. And in ion exchange chromatography, it's on charge. If the protein are having similar charge, you will be getting similar charge. So the best possible answer is polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis or SDS page. SDS page, what will it do? It destroys the protein, and so the charge is all neutralized. They will put a similar charge using an SDS. SDS will impart a uniform negative charge. So whatever charge the protein has will be neutralized or nullified by using SDS, and the page will separate the protein. It does not depend on the molecular weight. It will be destroyed and it will be separated depending on the size of the primary structure, not the secondary or tertiary structure. So through SDS page, you can get the purest form of protein. Then you can use it for other analysis. Even in isoelectric focusing, you can get purest form of protein. If the answer has 2D gel electrophoresis, that would be the best possible choice for the purity of protein. Because in 2D gel electrophoresis, in 1D we'll separate based on this page, polyacrylamide, and second we'll separate based on the charge. So you have both mass as well as charge separation. So you will get the purest form of protein. So this, what exactly this SDS page means? Sodium docetyl sulfate, that is SDS. So this will impart a negative charge on the protein. So once this protein is run, it will impart a uniform negative charge. Then what is this page? Polyacrylamide gel. So this gel, which is used, seen here, is made up of polyacrylamide page, right? Polyacrylamide. So it is a gel electrophoresis. That's why it is named as page, polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. So once you run the sample, depending on their size, it is separated. You can see the separated proteins here, and this is a molecular ladder. Means this is a reference run, so that you can see at which position your protein of interest is coming, at which molecular weight your protein of interest is coming. So this is how it is done, and the charge is applied depending on electrophoresis. This separation will be happening, and the principle behind is mass or the molecular weight. Molecular weight is the one used in SDS page. So wherever there is an SDS page, you should remember 2 points. One, the native structure is destroyed, you won't get native proteins. Two, SDS impart the uniform charge, so no charge is obtained. Three, it's based on molecular weight, and the technique uses electrophoresis or electrical charge, right? This is what you have to know about SDS page. The question based on that is, separation or detection of a protein by following method does not affect its function. So basically they want to know, you like SDS page will destroy the native structure. Here they would have given, there is a separation detection method which does not, means they do want to destroy the native structure or the function or the protein. So SDS page is out, right? That will destroy your charge also, destroy your protein primary structure also, it will denature. So this is gone. Next, separating it by denaturation. If the word denaturation means the nature has been destroyed or denatured. So here you don't want the protein to lose its function, means you don't want the protein to lose its nature, right? Separating it by denaturation, wrong. Detecting it by commercin blue dye after electrophoresis, okay, you can detect this. Detecting it with ultraviolet lace, wavelength of 280 nanometer. But 280 nanometer will give the presence or absence of protein, or the quantity of protein, present or absence or quantity, how much is present. It does not help in separation or detection of particular protein. So the answer, best possible answer, is commercin blue dye after electrophoresis. Electrophoresis help in separation, and commercin blue dye does not destroy the protein nature. So just remember those points for this phase. The next important types of question they will ask is case based question. These are the most typical questions. There are set of cases which we will be discussing, and you should know, you should be well versed in those type of question. They are very much necessary for your clinical practice also, for your cracking of exam also, and for understanding of biochemistry and clinical subjects also. So here I'll read out the question here, and we'll try to analyze this question so that we can answer the question given. Here the 23-year-old man develops stearorrhea, means there is a loss of fat in his stool. Then there is weight loss also, then bloody diarrhea also. He notes that diarrhea is worse when you eat bread or cereal, alright. A particular type of diet will worsen his diarrhea. Then gastroenterologist performed a biopsy which revealed a celiac disease. They are given the disease name here. That means they want the pathology behind it. They don't want the disease, to identify the disease. They have already given the disease name. So this disorder is most directly due to which of the following. So they want the pathology, what it exactly causes. So deficiency of enterokinase. Obviously deficiency of enterokinase will lead to your malabsorption, and malabsorption will lead to your bloody diarrhea or stearorrhea or other things. But it is not triggered by a dietary foods you take, right? So next choice, defective transport of amino acid system. Okay, then defective transport of neutral amino acid. So here they are cleverly given two amino acid transport deficiency choices. So if you don't know exactly what is celiac disease and what it exactly causes, it's caused by, we tend to choose, okay, they are given two adjacent MCQs or adjacent choices. So the answer could be between both of them. This both choice, what they are given is wrong. So the answer for this question is hypersensitivity to protein gluten. So the protein gluten is present in bread and cereals, and that person is having hypersensitivity to it. So once he eats this kind of food, there will be a reaction in his his GI tract, and this causes destruction of their cilia or the lining of the intestine. This leads to malabsorption, and malabsorption lead to loss of fat in the diet, which is passed into the stool, and malabsorption lead to weight loss. So all the symptoms the person is having is due to hypersensitivity to protein gluten, right? Even if they don't reveal the disease, if they don't give the disease name also, you should be able to answer this case, this question, by analyzing what is happening in the system, human system, and what is the biochemistry behind that, right? So now celiac disease is a non-tropical sprue resulting from hypersensitivity to gluten protein, right? This is celiac disease. So if someone does not know what is celiac disease, so that means it is hypersensitivity to a protein gluten. It is also called non-tropical sprue, right? And biopsy is the definitive diagnostic techniques to find out what disease the person is having. So in biopsy, what they will reveal is the surface, the gut surface is destroyed. There is flattening of villi. There, because of inflammatory response, immune system is acting against gluten, and wherever the gluten is present, it will have a collateral damage and it will destroy the villi, which is also present. So this leads to excess lipid in the fat, which is called sciuria, right? And the other choices which they are given, there is defective transport of cystine. It leads to cystinuria, and the disease it might cause is kidney stones. And defective transport of neutral amino acid or Hartnup disease. It is Hartnup disease. Remember, neutral amino acid excretion in urine is called Hartnup disease. That is because the transport of these amino acid is defective. It's a genetic abnormality. You are not able to transport this amino acid. Usually it remembered by the acronym COLA. COLA, that is cysteine, ornithine, lysine, arginine. These are the amino acid which are excreted in Hartnup disease. Then enterokinase, it's an enzyme which is activated in the pancreatic. It is secreted from pancreatic glands and into the intestinal lumen. So this helps in digestion, right? Absence of enterokinase will also lead to protein and fat malabsorption and digestion, but it does not cause destruction of gut epithelial cells. So the obvious choice for the above question is celiac disease, not the enterokinase defect. Okay. Now one more question based on the clinics is their favorite cystic fibrosis, right? Cystic fibrosis is their favorite question. Cystic fibrosis, right? Invariable number of questions are derived from cystic fibrosis. Now we'll learn about the cystic fibrosis, how they have framed a question based surrounding the cystic fibrosis. There are patients who are undergoing genetic disorder. They are undergoing a workup for genetic disorder. They order a test, and the test showed df phi naught 8. Remember this df phi naught 8 mutation. Whenever you hear df phi naught 8 mutation, that means it is related to cystic fibrosis, right? So what? Absence of phenylalanine at this position on the protein. Okay, they are given phenylalanine is absent at whenever there is a mutation at this protein. So what exactly the question is based is, what is it, what is true about this patient's condition? So they are given diagnosis. So now they want you to identify what happens in cystic fibrosis, right? Cystic fibrosis, the question here, the choices are, the patient will have a positive sweat chloride test. Obviously, the obvious answer, cystic fibrosis deals with chloride and it deals with high sweat or low sweat. It is detected by positive sweat chloride test. One of the screening tests is sweat chloride test, right? Next question, next choice. The patient will develop or have Duchenne muscle dystrophy. It is nothing to relate with this mutation. If someone does not know this mutation, DF, phi naught 8 mutation, is related to cystic fibrosis, then they will have the dilemma of choosing other choices. If you know so this DF phi naught 8 is cystic fibrosis, then you don't have much trouble in eliminating the other choice. The patient will develop or has Duchenne muscle dystrophy, wrong. Likelihood of Alzheimer's disease with this mutation. This mutation does not deal with Alzheimer's disease. Alzheimer's, you have something called amyloid protein which are accumulated. So that is not due to a mutation. Marfan syndrome. So Marfan syndrome is dealing with a mutation in fibrillin gene, not with the gene of your chloride transporter. So this choice is also not there. So, there could be another choices also. There will be a von Willebrand disease. It could be a G6PD. Any number of choices they can use for replacing the existing choice. But if you know this mutation, DF5NOT8, deals with cystic fibrosis, and cystic fibrosis deals with chloride metabolism, and this it is connected with the positive sweat chloride test, and also it causes your respiratory disorders, right? Because the mucus will be thickened, and it deals with the cyst formation in pancreas. So then any number of choices or any number of explanation if they give for the choice, you will be able to eliminate them and you will be able to answer any quest they give for the question as well as the choices. Okay. The same thing is explained here. The patient is having cystic fibrosis and it is a mutation, hereditary disease. It affects exocrine glands, that is most probably lung, liver, pancreas and intestine. So in lung, liver is lung, it causes respiratory distress. And in liver, it forms cysts, and in pancreas also, it blocks the ducts and it can lead to pancreatitis and other abnormalities. And the mutation, which is famous, which is present in most of the patient of cystic fibrosis, this is not the only mutation which is present in cystic fibrosis, but it is the most common mutation which is present. And it can be used for confirmatory diagnosis also. That is DF phi naught 8 mutation. This can be detected by genetic testing. Okay. So this, what exactly happens when this mutation, if till now it, this question has not come, but still if it comes with this mutation, there is exchange of phenylalanine at, there is deletion of an amino acid which code for phenylalanine at 508 position of a protein called CFTR, that is chloride transporter protein. So the protein which is affected is CFTR due to DF phi naught 8 mutation. And what happens in this mutation is it deletes the amino acid. So this mutation causes deletion of phenylalanine at 508 position. That's why the name given 508. This is deletion at 508 position. So for a amino acid to be deleted, you know, amino acid is coded by triplicate code. There has to be a 3 base deletion. So this cystic fibrosis happens with 3 base deletion. Diagnosis, obviously, it should be a newborn screening, because as the patient get older, the more complication of lung and pancreas will ensure, and they will be a failure to thrive. Then they detect by high level of salt in patient's sweat, right? This test, the sweat chloride test, is used as a screening test. Sweat chloride is used as a screening test for cystic fibrosis. Duchenne muscle dystrophy, the gene is dystrophin gene. Alzheimer's disease, it is abnormal folding of protein that leads to amyloid precursor protein accumulation and beta amyloid neurofibrillary tangle. Just remember these words: Duchenne muscle dystrophy, dystrophin gene. Alzheimer's disease, you remember neurofibrillary tangle, amyloid precursor protein abnormality. Because this question can be easily changed. Mutation, instead of DF508 mutation, they would have given dystrophin gene mutation. Then the choice would be Duchenne muscle dystrophy. Right, Marfan also, they can give FBN1 gene or fibrinin1 gene mutation. Then the answer would be Marfan syndrome instead of cystic fibrosis. Von Willebrand disease also, it is related to coagulation system, not related to the transport of chloride or sweat chloride. And this will cause addition problem, right? So this could be additional questions regarding cystic fibrosis. Cystic fibrosis causes obstruction of what glands? That might be a question. It's exocrine gland, and they could be sweat glands, mucous glands, or pancreas. It could be any of the exocrine gland it can block. Then what type of disease is cystic fibrosis? The genetic inheritance also is favorite for the examiners. So they might ask what kind of disease it is. That is autosomal disease, and it is inherited recessively. So autosomal recessive disease, right? Then what is the single most accepted common diagnostic tool? It will be screening for sweat chloride, and confirmation will be 508 mutation, right? 508 mutation for cystic fibrosis. But most of them, sweat chloride with clinical symptoms, you will be able to diagnose cystic fibrosis. Next type of question is application based. Means they would give a clinical scenario and you have to apply that in your clinical practice to get the answers. Like here, they will give a CSF analysis, CSF biochemistry of glucose, protein, and lymphocyte or leukocytes, and they will try to analyze what type of meningitis, viral meningitis, bacterial meningitis. Similarly, they will give a picture of total bilirubin, direct bilirubin. Then they will try to analyze, they will give a choice of prehepatic jaundice, causes for prehepatic jaundice, hepatic jaundice, or post-hepatic jaundice. So jaundice diagnosis. In prehepatic, they would give hemolytic choices. In liver, hepatic, they would give alcoholic liver disease or something like that. Post-hepatic, they will give obstruction or gallbladder. So they will give a clinical picture of bilirubins and liver enzymes, and they might ask you to analyze like what disease they are talking about. Similarly, here you can see they are given CSF picture and they are asking what is your diagnosis, right? Here the choice, and they want you to diagnose in which condition they will be having viral meningitis, or it could be other way around. They would have given the glucose level or your protein level, and they would have given the choice viral meningitis, bacterial meningitis, fungal meningitis, or there is carcinoma or something like that. Then you should be able to answer those things. So for that, we are given a graph here. Bacterial meningitis, bacteria, they are aggressive, they use glucose very much. So there will be lot of glucose consumption. So there will be less glucose in CSF. Then proteins will be more. For bacterial meningitis, neutrophils will be more compared to lymphocyte. And Gram staining will be positive. And for sepsis, bacterial sepsis, we know lactate is a good marker. So you can, if you have a picture, low glucose, high protein, neutrophils, lactate high, the answer would be bacterial meningitis. Viral meningitis, the glucose is normal. This is the characteristic feature of viral meningitis. Glucose is normal. Instead of neutrophil, lymphocytes will be more for viral meningitis, right? So viral meningitis, lymphocyte will be more, glucose will be normal, and also the lactate will be normal. This is viral meningitis. Tuberculosis, the protein which is there, you have to worry about protein. Protein will be high and lymphocyte will be more, right? Glucose little bit will be lower, and characteristic, if they give cobweb, then that clinches the diagnosis of tubercular meningitis. Fungal meningitis, India ink. If they mention India ink instead of Gram staining, it is fungal meningitis. The protein, the glucose will be normal or slightly reduced. Lactate will be more. Instead of neutrophil, all pictures similar to bacterial meningitis, except your lymphocyte is there instead of neutrophils. This is fungal meningitis. And important thing with the bacterial, whenever there is any choice which shows low glucose, very much decreased glucose in CSF, that always diagnosis is bacterial meningitis. Here viral meningitis, the choices would be, you have to look for normal glucose level if there is viral meningitis. The normal glucose level with protein increased and polymorph. Here the polymorph is given. So viral meningitis is not polymorph, it is lymphocyte. If there is polymorph raised, it usually points to a different diagnosis. Polymorph usually will be for bacterial, but in bacterial you should always look for drastically reduced glucose level, right? Here the choice for viral meningitis is normal glucose level decreased, protein increased, lymphocyte raised. Okay, that would be the answer.